thanks for making it for, I think, the last talk of the evening. I'm going to be talking about caching, in particular, caching using LVM. I'm sure a lot of you know what LVM is. In fact, a lot of you probably know more about caching than I do, because I see a lot of familiar faces in the audience and a lot of people whom I have learned from. But for those of you who don't know what LVM is, it's basically a block level volume manager, the Linux volume manager, and it allows you to aggregate physical devices and create logical devices. Cache logical devices are one type of such device, and we're going to be seeing how to set these up and what caching is in general and what benefits it can get your IO applications. My name is Nikhil and I work in backline support for storage. I have been with Red Hat for about 5 years now, and LVM is one of the most frequent areas of my work when it comes to support. So everybody knows what we are talking about when we talk about caching. It exists at every layer of the stack, but the fact is that the IO subsystem has become the performance bottleneck, because CPUs have increased at speeds which are much faster than the backplane of IO subsystems for most organizations. The latency hit you get when you exit from the RAM subsystem and do your IO to the hard disk drives, which are still pretty much the backbone of storage infrastructure for most organizations, is in the order of several magnitudes. In fact, if you want to think about it in terms of layman figures, the RAM is as fast compared to a traditional hard disk drive as a supersonic fighter jet is compared to a snail. That is actually how slow IO is when it exits the RAM subsystem and starts being written out to these slow rotational magnetic disks. So there is a latency gap that exists, and solid state drives are pretty much filled in the gap. The problem is that when it comes to storage, you can either get you consider storage in terms of price, its size and its speed, and unless you have infinite budget, and nobody does, you could get two of these three things. So the idea is to efficiently use each layer and take as much as you want of your fast expensive storage, take as much as you need of your slow large capacity storage, and put together a hybrid solution that can be used for accelerating your IO. The dream situation is, of course, that you pay for a slower device but you get the performance of a faster device, and the way to do this is to cache as intelligently as possible. A lot of hardware manufacturers, if not all, have begun offering hard disks with caches coupled into them. So you don't only see this in standalone devices, you also see them at the storage array level where your controller cache could be such devices. The idea is, of course, the same. The flash would store most often frequently accessed files, and while it does help, the basic problem is that you can't tune much, neither can you decouple nor increase the size of the cache. And so what we're going to be talking about today is doing the same kind of thing but at the software level using LVM. So in LVM, a logical volume is composed of one or more storage devices. So you aggregate physical devices and make them into logical volumes. Like I said at the start, a cached logical volume is a combination of a slow, which I would call an origin device, and a fast, which I would refer to the cache device. LV create, which is the command you use to create these logical volumes, allows you to specify the actual disk or the actual device you want to use for this logical volume. And typically you would use the fast disk to create your cached logical volumes, and your slow disk we would assume is actually in existence and in fact with a file system on it and currently serving IO. The idea is that the fast device would boost the speed, but it's not going to aggregate your storage capacity. So the total storage capacity you have is the storage capacity of your slower disk. What the cache would do is actually typically store frequently accessed blocks of the slower disk and service IO requests, if those blocks are cached, IO requests would be serviced from the fast device without having to go to the slow device. So when we talk about caching, all data stored on the fast devices eventually makes their way to the slow device. Depending on the behavior you set up, it could make a difference in terms of how long that takes, depending on the way you tune your hybrid volume. But eventually, you would never be in a situation where the loss of your fast device would result in loss of data. At least that is the end goal. That's because it's keeping a copy. It's not keeping the... Eventually, whatever the fast device stores, it will flush it to the slower device for safety, so that you would never be in a situation of data loss if the fast device went away. I repeated that because I saw you a little puzzled about that.
A couple of years ago, I have read a blog entry of one of our fellow Red Hatters. I don't remember his name, but there was a statement that if the SSD is gone away, then you lose some data.
You would lose the data.
If it, over the years.
You would lose the data if it goes away in the progress of making the write back. But once write back finishes and it has flushed everything, then if you lose the fast device, you lose only the cached layer. You would not lose your data.
Okay, so you do not have complete data loss, just partial data loss.
It depends at what stage you lose the fast device. If you lose it in the progress of write back, then yes, there would be data loss. But the goal is to get the data to the slower device eventually, depending on how you tune it. There's two ways to cache I/O using LVM, depending on your workload. And what has happened is a distinction between read caching and read write caching. Read write caching and write caching. So the older way of doing things was the DM cache device mapper target. DM cache has been around for a long time. It made the mainline kernel in 3.9, I think, more than 6 years ago. Very often used by customers for their caching solutions, and the cache would get populated by both reads and writes, which means that if you would access certain blocks frequently enough on the slower disk, they would be promoted to the cache. So DM cache would do these kind of promotions based on a hit count, how many times a certain block may be accessed on the slower device. DM write cache is the newer target. It was mainlined less than a year ago, I believe, and has recently been integrated into LVM upstream. It has not yet found its way into RHEL, but probably in the next RHEL version you would see the DM write cache target and basically integrated with LVM. The other thing I wanted to mention is caches can be added to file to logical volumes which have active file systems on them. So you may not really get a performance hit during the addition of the cache. Both the DM targets that exist, which are integrated with LVM, let you do that. There are other caching solutions where it's non-trivial to do that, which would wipe the origin device when you set up the cache. So it's difficult to set up caching on an active file system without having to unmount it and actually wipe it clean, which is one of the main advantages why you would like to use the LVM integrated caching methods. So let's talk about DM cache for a bit. Like I said, DM cache does cache promotions and cache demotions, so frequently accessed blocks on the origin would be moved to the cache. Initially, when you set it up, it would be a cold cache. So the first time you set up DM cache, you would see performance which is worse than if you had no caching at all, because the cache is cold. Nothing has been promoted, nothing has been moved to the cache. After you use it for a certain amount of time, the cache would become warm and certain blocks would be promoted to the cache. And then you would start to see the performance boost that you expect when you're using caching. Fast devices in DM cache are represented by a cache pool. A cache pool is a type of logical volume which would have a metadata and a data logical volume. If you know anything about thin provisioning, and if you've seen thin pools, it's the same kind of concept. What you would do is create a cache pool, which is actually just a linear logical volume, and then attach it to your slow existing logical volumes, which would create a hybrid cache logical volume. There are ways to create this quickly and let LVM auto-create the metadata and the data logical volumes, and in fact even auto-create the cache pool itself. And I'm going to show you the quick way and the slow way to do it in the slides. The cache can also be detached online. So when you detach the cache using the split cache flag to LV convert, what would happen is all the pending dirty blocks, and a block would be dirty, marked as dirty if it had been changed on the cache but not in the origin, and those dirty blocks would need to be flushed to disk before you deactivate the cache. So that would be done when you do a split cache on the cache. You would have a flush, hopefully not too long, because DM cache typically does end up writing data to the origin device quite fast. It doesn't have data lying around only in the cache for too long. There's three modes that you can set up. There's the write back mode, which means that your IO will be signaled complete to the application when it reaches the fast device only. So you need not wait for the IO to be written back to the slower device before the application thinks of it as complete. There's the write through mode, which is what it defaults to in RHEL, at least. What write through says is IO will not be marked as complete until it reaches both the devices. So the write through mode is actually beneficial only for read caching. It's not really beneficial for write caching, but it is safety first, because by default we don't want customers to be in a situation where, like you said, there could be any incident of data loss at all. There is also the pass through mode, not used very often. It is generally used if the cache is not coherent and you want to still activate such a device without actually using the cache. So everything would bypass the cache in such a mode. And here's an example of how to do this with a cache pool. It is basically just these two commands that you have to remember. Assume that you already have a slower logical volume with a mounted file system on it, which has in progress IO. That's cool. And you create a fast logical volume. If you notice, the first LV create creates a 1 gig linear logical volume, which you would call your cache pool, or name it C pool. And you specify which device you want to use for creating this fast logical volume. And you would then create a cache pool automatically, as well as tie it to the origin and create a hybrid cached LV, all in this one step, this LV convert step that I've shown. And at the end of this process, you would see this output, which would basically leave your origin name, but the type would be changed to a hybrid cached volume, which you could see in the attributes over here. It's no longer a linear logical volume, it's a cached logical volume now, it's a hybrid logical volume. And you will have five hidden logical volumes created, auto-created, which LVM would not show you if you just run the LVS command, but this is a LVS all output. And this is what it would internally use for, it's appropriately named. So there's the cache pool, which is auto-created, which becomes hidden, the data and the metadata, a spare for repair if needed, and the original, which is renamed to underscore C orig volume. If all this seems confusing, just remember that at the end of that step, you have the same named logical volume as your origin logical volume. IO is in progress as before, but will start being cached. And this is the long way to do it. I wanted to have this as reference, so if anybody looked at these steps, or if anybody saw the slides, they would get an idea of how to achieve maximum flexibility. Notice you have two LV converts here, because you are manually creating the cache pool, because you have created your data and metadata separately. So this is useful if you want to have, for example, different RAID levels on your data and metadata. For example, you would want to probably mirror your metadata device, you would probably want to stripe, or you would want to have a RAID 5 setup on your data device. And you may also want to use different devices for the data and the metadata. Suppose you have some super fast storage, which you want to use for the metadata, and you have some fast, reasonably fast storage, which you would use for the data. So that kind of flexibility is available to you. And you can go ahead and look at these steps. The slides will be sent out. I don't want to spend too much time going through the entire stack, but it's pretty much what we saw in the last slide, but with additional flexibility of doing each step and having separate data and metadata logical volumes. We also have cache walls now. Cache walls can be thought of cache pools without a user accessible data or metadata. You would never see a metadata or data logical volumes even if you try running LVS-A like you did in the earlier slide. And the idea is that the metadata and data are combined into one internal logical volume used by the cache wall. The way to create it is pretty much the same if you notice. It's just that I give a cache wall instead of a cache pool to the command. So let's talk about dm-writecache. This is the new caching target. Merged into 4.18 by Mikulas, who's right here. So you all know whom to ask questions to. Integrated by David recently into an LVM version, which would go into the next major release of RHEL, which would be packaged with RHEL. dm-writecache is only write back, no write through. And that makes sense because we are trying to accelerate only writes here. It's useful for applications like database, which need low commit latencies for transactional consistency, where they cannot afford to have data lying around in the page cache at all. So they want to get it as fast as possible to persistent storage. Optimized for PMEM devices in terms of how quickly or how often it will flush, but also very useful for NVMe-based SSD devices. Only uses cache walls, you cannot use cache pools. And there is no flush without eviction. So every time data is flushed to the slower device, it is evicted from the cache. All writes will be cached. Only writes will be cached. Reads will be serviced from the cache. But if you read from the slower device, no matter how often you read the same block, there will never be a promotion from the slower device to the faster device on the basis of that read. The idea is that reads may generally be available in the RAM page cache, so you could get it from there. And if you really think about it, reads and writes are quite different when it comes to caching, right? If you send a write request, the operating system will typically cache it unless you use direct IO. It will be cached in page cache, and you will be told, the application will be told, sure, consider it. It's written, done, right? When you do a read request, the OS has to actually deliver. It can't say consider it read. It has to actually give you the contents. And so having two different targets is an attempt to actually isolate one for a particular kind of workload and the other for another kind of workload. And that's basically the idea behind having these two caching targets now available for applications to use. As of today, detaching the cache disk would require deactivation of the logical volume in dm-writecache. Not like DM cache, which lets you detach online too, but there is work being done which will in the future allow you to detach as well online. The same kind of output for DM write cache. As you can see, you are using a type write cache instead of a type cache, and a cache wall. You cannot use cache pool, like I mentioned, and it's pretty much the same kind of output. Your origin device would retain its name, but it would become a hybrid write cached logical volume. Usage of the cache cannot be seen at the LVM layer right now, but give us a few months and that will come into LVM, so you can see the usage of the cache in terms of how much of the cache you have free. Today it can be seen using the DM setup status. The fields which I have marked would give you an idea of how much cache you have, how much is free, and how many jobs are being used to flush this to the origin, if at all a write back is in progress. These are tunables for DM write cache. These can be set when you set up the cache using LVM. These can also be changed dynamically using the DM setup command today. Again, there will be a patch going into LVM in the future which would let you make these tuning changes dynamically after setting up the cache. The high watermark is basically the level of usage of the cache after which a write back would automatically start. Low watermark would be the percentage till when write back would continue. So after 45% by default, no more write back will happen. The write back jobs is the last figure that I showed you in the DM setup status command, and these are basically the number of threads that will be spawned for basically flushing data. There are also other tunables for how quickly to flush. So after a certain number of blocks are committed, a write back will begin. After a certain amount of time has passed, a write back will begin. And these are optimized more for persistent memory, as you can see. So that's basically the idea I'm trying to get across here. I think we have 5 minutes for questions. I just have a references slide, but if you have any questions, you can, you know, there's a lot of experts in the room, so just feel free to.
So the default caching mode for DM cache is write through. Do you have the same issues that this gentleman was talking about in that case? With the data getting back to the backing store?
No, you would not, because I/O would be signal complete only after it reaches the backing store.
Okay.
So it would result in a performance hit for writes, but it would be a safe way to cache. You would get a performance boost for reads only in that case.
How well does it scale? I see in your examples you use like 5 gigabytes or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
I use 3 terabytes
mm-hmm.
or a 10 terabyte drive, and I didn't really see that much usage. I didn't see the speed up that I expected.
Did you use dm-writecache?
Yes.
So
I use dm-cache with writeback.
You use dm-cache with writeback. Yes, so if you see the LVM.conf file, you will see a limit of 1 million chunks. And if you use a cache size which would need more than that, then instead of increasing the number of chunks, the chunk size would increase. And you would have an equal increase in the migration threshold. So you would be promoting and demoting in larger chunks, which could be affecting your performance.
Is there any suggested ratio between cache and backend storage in order to get
The suggested ratio is actually more in terms of your working set, so the size of your data. If you have, for example, a 5 GB cache, and if you're doing streaming writes to video files, which are constantly going to be larger than the cache, eventually you will not get much boost. You will not get much of a performance boost from that cache. If you have a working set which is doing reads or writes, at sufficient intervals for the cache to be able to write back and then wait for the next burst, so that is when you would get the optimal performance. So the ratio is the how big you want the cache to be should probably depend on what is the working set of your data.
You can find a data called DM stats, which can give you a very good measurement. What is your
DM cache for read only?
Sorry, can you repeat?
DM cache and read only mode. Or read only for reads, of course.
DM cache. So you would like to only cache reads?
Yeah.
I don't know if you can do that. We don't have a read only cache.
Write through mode.
Write through mode.
But he means only promoting things that are read. And never counting for writes, and the answer is no.
Yeah.
Sure.
Before you have told us about cache walls and cache pools, I'm not fully understanding the differences between those two things.
Okay. Cache pools give you access to the internal metadata and data logical volumes if you want to separate them onto separate devices or read either of them at a different level. Cache walls use them internally, and the sysadmin or the creator of these logical volumes has no access to the internal metadata and data logical.
So at the end, which one is the best thing to use?
Well, if you want greater flexibility, then you would use the cache pools. If you want ease of use and one command which does it all, you would use the cache walls. I think we are out of time, so thank you all for making it.